Welcome to this class on Neuroscience of Human Movement. In today's class, we'll be discussing about neuromuscular junction. In this class, we'll be introducing the notion of motor neurons and introducing muscles and muscle fibers. We'll discuss the concept of neuromuscular junction in relatively good detail. And we'll discuss synaptic transmission. We'll discuss postsynaptic potential and its types, IPSP and EPSP. An inhibitory postsynaptic potential and excitatory postsynaptic potential and temporal and spatial summation, right. So, we have seen earlier that a neuron has a cell body soma and several dendrites that are the input structures, and the output structure is the axonal terminal, is it not? If this axon terminal terminates at a muscle or a muscle fiber, then it could cause depolarization of that muscle fiber. Let us remember that both neurons and muscle fibers are excitatory cells. Both of them can have action potentials in them, okay, because they maintain a steady potential difference across their membrane. So, they both have the same characteristics or similar characteristics in terms of having a sodium potassium pump, having a influx of sodium causing an action potential, etc., right. So, if the neuron connects to a muscle fiber, it not only causes an action potential in the muscle fiber, but it also causes the muscle fiber to contract or produce force. Now, in that respect, the muscle fiber is different from a neuron. A neuron can only produce and conduct action potentials, whereas a muscle fiber can not only produce and conduct action potential, but also produce a force. As to how the muscle produces a force, we will discuss in future classes, right. The neurons that synapse with, that connect with muscle fibers are called as motor neurons. Motor means movement, and movement in the body is produced by contraction of muscles, right. So, neurons that cause muscle contraction are called as motor neurons. So, these motor neurons are located at the ventral side of the spinal cord. So, when an animal is on all fours, when an animal is on its four limbs, right. So, as in a quadruped is on its four limbs, the part of the body that faces the ground is called as the ventral side, and the part of the body that faces the roof or the sky is called as the dorsal side, okay. So, the ventral side of the spinal cord houses ganglia or nuclei that contain a large number of motor neurons. These are the neurons that synapse with muscle fibers and cause the muscles to produce a force. And there is also relatively precise control of the force that is produced by the muscle. These neurons that synapse with or connect with muscle fibers are called as motor neurons, and it turns out that one neuron can connect with a whole number of muscle fibers. One neuron and all the muscle fibers connected to it are called together as a motor unit. So, this is different from a motor neuron. So, let us consider this part of the picture as the presynaptic neuron, okay. So, this is the presynaptic neuron or the motor neuron, and that side of the picture shown here is the muscle fiber, okay, or the postsynaptic muscle, the muscle fiber side, okay. Now, what happens, what causes an action potential in the muscle fiber, how is that conducted, that is of interest for us. What are the mechanisms that is of interest for us, right. So, the nerve impulse or the action potential arrives from, say, the axon hillock towards the synaptic end bulb or the axonal terminal, right. How does it arrive? The usual method of action potential propagation. Basically, one action potential causes the neighboring areas. So, when this action potential arrives, say at that point, okay, it is important to note that the synaptic end bulb or the axonal terminal of the motor neuron contains a relatively large number of these special channels. These channels are voltage gated calcium channels. Now, these channels are going to be opened whenever the potential is above a certain threshold. So, when action potential arrives, to these points, these voltage gated calcium channels open. Okay, so these voltage gated calcium channels open and a lot of calcium enters inside the cell. What does this do to the muscle, or what does this do to the presynaptic neuron? That is the question. So, it turns out we discussed in one of the previous classes that acetylcholine is synthesized by a protein, choline acetyl transferase, right? Choline acetyl transferase synthesizes acetylcholine from two components. One is acetyl coenzyme A and choline. Both of these are combined together to produce acetylcholine. Who is producing this? The protein choline acetyl transferase, so CAT. CAT is producing acetylcholine, and it is packed into bags, into relatively small bags called as vesicles. Okay. So, it is packed into acetylcholine vesicles, and these acetylcholine vesicles have special calcium sensors called as synaptotagmin. So, these calcium sensors, they detect the presence of calcium. When the calcium level is higher, what they do is they move the vesicle closer to the membrane, right? They move the vesicle closer to the membrane and fuse with the membrane and then open on the outside, releasing the chemical acetylcholine on the outside through a process called exocytosis. Let us go to a different picture and look at that situation. Whenever action potential is caused in the presynaptic neuron, and when it travels to the synaptic end bulb, these calcium channels are opened and a lot of calcium enters inside, and these synaptic vesicles contain a calcium sensor, which is the protein synaptotagmin, and that synaptotagmin causes the or senses the presence of calcium and begins a series of activities that lead to the fusing of the vesicle with the membrane. This is mediated by docking proteins called syntaxin and synaptobrevin. So, by the action of syntaxin and synaptobrevin, these vesicles fuse to the membrane and then open up on the outside. So, action potential arrives, and then that leads to opening of the calcium channel, and then as soon as the amount of calcium in the synaptic end bulb goes above a certain level, that is detected by synaptotagmin, that causes movement of the vesicle towards the membrane and docking of the vesicle. And docking of the vesicle with the membrane by the action of the docking protein syntaxin and synaptobrevin, and then opening up of the vesicle on the outside. Note, once the vesicle opens outside, basically what is outside this? This is the extracellular fluid, is it not? This is the extracellular fluid. This is the gap between the muscle fiber. Note, this is the muscle fiber. This is the space between the muscle fiber and the neuron, that is the extracellular fluid, right? So, how is this acetylcholine transported in the extracellular fluid? Purely by diffusion. There is no control, there is no specific conditions that mediate that transport of acetylcholine from the presynaptic neuron to the postsynaptic muscle fiber. It happens purely through diffusion. Of course, diffusion related loss may come into the picture, but let us remember that this is a relatively small gap. Okay. So, acetylcholine moves from that side to this side. And now, what happens on the postsynaptic side? That is the question. What happens on the postsynaptic side? It turns out the postsynaptic side has receptors. These are like locks waiting to be opened. Okay. So, that is the ligand-gated ion channel. This is called as a ligand-gated ion channel, or also called as a nicotinic cholinergic receptors. These are like locks. Whenever acetylcholine comes and attaches to this lock, so acetylcholine is the key that is going to open this lock. So, whenever acetylcholine comes and attaches to the nicotinic cholinergic receptors, these receptors, which are basically channels, these channels open and let in sodium inside. So, basically these are slightly different from the regular stimulus driven sodium channels or voltage gated sodium channels. These are ligand gated sodium channels which open only when that particular chemical, in this case acetylcholine, attaches to them. When acetylcholine attaches to this receptor, the channel opens and lets in a lot of sodium. And this influx of sodium could cause, say for example, this is the muscle fiber, and say here you have a voltage gated sodium channel, say for example. Now, this influx of sodium could take this voltage gated sodium channel to threshold, causing a greater influx of sodium and an action potential in the muscle fiber. How this muscle fiber produces force is a topic for future classes, but for now it is sufficient for us to know that when sodium enters inside via the ligand gated sodium channel or the nicotinic cholinergic receptors, it basically could, and in many cases does, cause the action potential in a muscle fiber. So, some terminology regarding the neuromuscular junction. End plate potential. So, spontaneously from the presynaptic terminal without the necessity for an action potential to arrive. Because of this reason, a small amount of acetylcholine reaches the postsynaptic terminal and causes a relatively small amount of depolarization or a graded potential. Okay. So, this graded potential or local depolarization is called as end plate potential. Okay. So, the end plate potential is a local depolarization or a graded potential of the motor end plate and is not an action potential important. And let us assume that only one acetylcholine molecule attaches to, let us assume that only one acetylcholine molecule attaches to a nicotinic cholinergic receptor that causes entry of a small amount of sodium in the muscle fiber that slightly causes depolarization, that causes a slight depolarization of the muscle fiber. This is the smallest possible change in the membrane potential of the motor end plate that is caused due to one acetylcholine molecule, that is called as the miniature end plate potential. So, the end plate potential is a local depolarization or a graded potential that is caused due to spontaneous release of acetylcholine from the presynaptic membrane, not necessarily due to action potential. Whereas, miniature end plate potential is the smallest change in membrane potential of the muscle fiber that is caused due to one acetylcholine molecule. Now, entry of acetylcholine and the influx of sodium causes an excitation in the muscle fiber, right? This postsynaptic potential is excitatory, and so it is called as excitatory postsynaptic potential, as we have seen in previous classes. This depolarizes the postsynaptic muscle fiber. It is also possible for a postsynaptic potential to be inhibitory, depending on the particular chemical, depending on whether that is acetylcholine or say GABA, there may be either excitation or inhibition. Also, depending on the particular receiver, depending on the particular receptor, it is possible for a chemical to cause either an excitatory postsynaptic potential or an inhibitory postsynaptic potential. So, it is possible for a chemical, for a neurotransmitter to cause inhibition in the postsynaptic side. This is called as inhibitory postsynaptic potential. This is usually caused, for example, due to inhibitory neurotransmitters such as GABA, right. This hyperpolarizes the postsynaptic membrane, right. And then we saw what are spatial and temporal summation. If at the same time several inputs arrive from multiple points in space, it is called as a, and that if at a point in time, if at a particular point in time multiple inputs arrive from several points in space and that information is summed or integrated to produce an action potential or cause some outcome, that is called a spatial summation. If at the same point in space multiple inputs arrive relatively close in time, it is possible for the inputs to be summed one after the other. This is called as temporal summation, as we have seen in previous classes. So, what we have seen end plate potential, we have seen miniature end plate potential, we have seen EPSP, IPSP, and we have seen spatial and temporal summation. So, in summary, we have seen that motor commands travel from motor neurons to muscles via the neuromuscular junction, which is mediated by the neurotransmitter acetylcholine. The how acetylcholine causes this is something that we have seen, and synaptic transmission at neuromuscular junction via acetylcholine neurotransmitter we have seen in relatively greater detail. So, in summary, what we have seen is motor commands reach the muscle via the NMJ or the neuromuscular junction, and that is mediated by acetylcholine neurotransmitter, right. Important terminologies, we have seen end plate potential, we have seen miniature end plate potential, we have seen excitatory postsynaptic potential, we have seen inhibitory postsynaptic potential, and we have seen spatial and temporal summation of postsynaptic or presynaptic potentials. So, for his contribution to our understanding of neurotransmission that happens, that the idea that neurotransmitters are packed in bags or in vesicles was first discovered by Sir Bernard Katz. For his contribution to this, he was awarded a Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine 1970. It's an inspiring story about him. So, please do check Google for Bernard Katz and read his story. For science, he had to practically run away from an anti-Semitic Germany and took refuge in A.V. Hill's lab, where he lived practically until he could survive, and what a fantastic career he has had. So, it's an inspiring story, please do read about it. I'll stop here. So, with this we come to the end of this lecture. We'll continue in future classes. Thank you very much for your attention.